Hi, my name's Dr. Padilla. I'm a professor in computer science and psychology, and I've been a professor for over 5 years now. Today, I wanted to talk about something that is very important to your PhD applications, and that's a letter of recommendation. So I want to talk about what is the power of a good letter of recommendation, how do you get those letters of recommendation, and what can they do for increasing your chances? So let's jump on in. Okay, so let's first talk about why does a letter of recommendation matter? They actually matter more than ever. What has been happening in PhD applications is that we're sort of losing different metrics of evaluating students, in particular the GRE, which was a general test that people used to have to take, has been going away. So now what's going on is that there's fewer and fewer ways that we can evaluate possible students, and that's why a letter of recommendation matters so much. The letter of recommendation is really someone else in the field that is endorsing you as an individual. They will give personal experiences about working with you and really help contextualize you as an applicant. This is incredibly important because the other evaluation metrics that you have in your application are very hard to compare across applicants. For example, we have your entire transcript. So that has all of the classes that you've taken throughout all of your education, but those vary significantly in terms of how to evaluate them across universities. Some universities might have very hard courses. So getting a B or a C in those very hard courses might be just as good as getting an A in some other universities. So it's really hard to compare across the different levels. And then the other major thing in your application is a personal statement or research statement, and those are also very hard to compare across students. Sometimes people didn't have sufficient preparation to write those letters or didn't know what needed to go in those letters. So sometimes they might be a fantastic candidate and they could be really good in academia, but their statement isn't reflective of their potential. So that's why letters of recommendation are so important. It is an outside person that's observing you, that is describing your skills and qualities, potentially in a way that you didn't even evaluate yourself. So they are very, very important. So the first thing you must do is find the right recommenders. You usually need 3 letters of recommendation, but pro tip, you can actually get more if you have more. You can get 4 or 5. There's no reason why you have to just get 3. 3 is a minimum, but you can have more than that. But more important than how many letters you get are who you get those letters from. The best letters come from people who know the most about you. So these are individuals that you've worked with more than a year, potentially. Sometimes even 3 or 4 years, they are the best. You really want to think about someone who can give you a very in-depth, detailed letter. What tends to happen is there's 2 categories of letters. One that are very rich, they have lots of personal experiences, they have evidence of your success, they have multiple different projects or things that they've worked with you on, and they can talk about your strengths and your weaknesses. That's one type of letter. The other type of letter is from someone who just doesn't know you very well. Maybe you've taken a class from them, and maybe you got a grade in that class. That person has taught dozens of classes, had hundreds of students, so it will be hard for them to write about you specifically. They'll be able to comment about your performance in the class because they will look it up, but they might not even remember you, I'm sorry to say. So you really want letters from that first category of people. These are people who know you very well. And you want to think about different categories of people within that more thoughtful letter writer category. You can look at people that you've worked with directly. These would be people that you've done research with that can speak to your ability in the discipline that you're applying to be in. Those are fantastic. Another category is a general mentor that can speak about you as a person, maybe your intellectual prowess, but they haven't worked with you on a particular research project per se. And then another important category is a collaborator. This might be someone who you've worked with, but they weren't directly your mentor. So they can talk about how it is working with you in a kind of a parallel fashion where they didn't give you an assignment per se, but you worked collaboratively together. Across all of those, the key is to find people that are in the highest seniority levels of their discipline. So we are talking full professors are the best, followed by associate and then assistant professors. That is the ranking of professors. The higher up in that category you get, the better. The next important thing to think about is actually getting strong letters from those individuals. So what you must do, of course, is email those people. And I have a whole video on eliciting strong letters of recommendation, but I'll kind of summarize here. The main thing that you want to do is when you are emailing them, you want to provide them with as much fodder to write a good letter as possible. So this includes reminding them of the things that you've worked on, even potentially consider sending them a bullet-pointed list of some of the accomplishments that you have in the field, things that you might want them to highlight in the letter. Of course, you want to ask them if they'd be willing to write you a letter. Not everyone is. Sometimes they don't have enough personal experience with you, so you have to, you know, navigate that situation. But if they are willing to write a letter for you, you want to see them with useful information that they can pack into that letter. When you do that, you want to include your CV. You want to also include your statement of purpose or your research statement, whatever statement you're including in your PhD application. Then they can use some of that information to describe you as a particular candidate. And when you're reaching out to people, you really want to talk about your passion for the particular role that you're applying to work in. They will include some of that in the letter. So you're really kind of seeding that letter with really fertile ground. Now, when you're asking for a letter of recommendation, it's great to include all of those things, but you need to recognize that sometimes people might decline to write you a letter. That might mean that they don't have enough to say positively about you. And usually what happens is rather than submitting a negative letter, they will just decline to submit a letter for you. So that can happen for a few reasons, right? They don't have a positive experience with you, or they truly don't have the time. So you really have to understand that. When you're reaching out to them, also thank them for their time. Recognize that they're very busy. I'm sure they've been asked to write many letters and you just valued their time so far and you would really appreciate a strong letter of recommendation. So now that you've asked for a letter and they've agreed to write a letter for you, there's some things you need to do to maximize your chance of actually getting those strong letters. Number one is you need to be very clear about the timelines. Professors are busy and they will forget. I forget all of the time. So what you want to do is in your return letter to them, outline the different places you're applying to and when those deadlines are. And what will happen is as those deadlines approach, feel free to email them again about a week prior to the deadline, just reminding them that there is a letter of recommendation coming in. And if the deadline is in one day, also do a third follow-up email saying, hey, by the way, the due date for that letter of recommendation is tomorrow, for example. It happens to me all the time. I just plan to submit a letter and I forget. And I really appreciate someone reminding me that that letter of recommendation is due tomorrow and then I'll get it in immediately. So once someone has agreed to write a letter for you, it is very rare that they will rescind that agreement. So if they are not actually submitting that letter, it's simply because they forgot and they need some reminders. Now, beyond the letter of recommendation, how do you make your application stand out? The trick is to think about your application as a package. Your letters of recommendation are one piece of that package and you want all of those pieces to fit together. So you want your personal or your research statement or your statement of purpose, whatever it's called in your field, to fit with those letters. You want them all to agree and to say that this person is the best candidate for this particular application because of X, Y, or Z. So it's best to find these talking points that are easy to remember that you can hit over and over and over again. I'm unifying these three fields. My letters of recommendation are from individuals in those fields who can attest that I am well suited to conduct this work, right? You want all of these things to be supportive of the package of yourself. And as you're thinking about the package of yourself, think about future letter writers as well. Maybe you're trying to integrate multiple fields and you don't have letter writers from each of those fields. This would be a great opportunity to seek out individuals in those fields to really ensure that you are a full-bodied candidate. That means potentially starting collaborations with them, working on their projects, attending lab meetings, etc. You want to think about this as an opportunity of building your community, and the letter writers are an illustration of this community that you are working to forge. I hope this video is useful. I hope you get glowing letters of recommendation. I know academia can be tough, but you don't have to go through it alone. Keep learning, keep growing, and I'll catch you in the next one. Take care.